Welcome to Up, Up, Down, Down. I'm your host, Austin Creed, and today on Superstar Save Point, we have the lovely lady, Lacey Evans.
Stop.
Just a vision. Thank you for coming in today.
Thank you for having me.
Oh, of course. Now, everyone on the channel has a nickname. What would you like your nickname to be?
Limitless Lady.
Ooh. Ooh.
That's a mouthful.
Welcome, the Limitless Lady. And so, I know that you've got a background in the military.
Yes, I do.
You've been through the ringer. We have a game for you called Quick Draw.
Okay.
So, if you don't mind, I'd like to pair off with you and test those skills.
If you don't mind losing, I'm ready to go.
Wow, strong words.
Ready.
No laughing.
Steady.
Cheers.
Fire!
Oh, my finger slipped. That's we're redoing
you
that.
You got me though.
Lord, what? Look at me.
Even with the finger slip. That's fine, fair. Okay, so juicy, you get this one.
A little easy on that trigger finger, honey.
I've got to relax. I need more training. So you being with your military experience, what was your experience like?
I was a military police officer and secondary MOS on a SWAT team, which is SRT, Special Reactions Team. And I did 5 years active duty, 3 in active reserve, and I loved it. I miss it every day.
Yeah.
Every day. I didn't wear this. I didn't look like this.
No, really?
No. I was good at my job. So.
I feel like you'd be able to hide a bunch of stuff from there, like secret agent
you
style.
Would think, but it's not very tactical. You know what I mean? A lot of things get in the way.
So then did you always have this in your mind when you were wearing that? You felt like this?
No. I felt like one of the boys, to be honest with you, because I mean, I was the only female on the SWAT team, so I wore what they wore, slicked my hair back, put my cover on, my hat, and ran in and did what we had to do, and I just never thought of dresses or didn't have time for that.
Yeah.
Dresses, makeup, it wasn't even in regulation anyways.
Yeah.
So, you know, I held myself to the highest standard in the Marine Corps, so
yeah,
I was one of the boys for sure.
Yeah. So were there, I assume that there were some barriers that you had to break through to get to where you were. Like, is there any of that that you could speak on?
Oh, yeah. There's many. I mean, it's already hard enough. So in the Marine Corps, it's, I don't know what the percentage is now because I've been out for 3 years, but back then it was like roughly 6% women. Mm-hmm. So there's already very few women that either want to or can make it as a United States Marine. And then in my field of work, being a military police officer, the numbers were even smaller. Mm-hmm. So every training school that I went to, I mean, it was rough because you were going against these strong men, these brave men. And everybody thinks, you know, in comparison to women, you know, men are obviously the stronger, the faster. So there was a lot of big shoes you had to fill every day in every training scenario. Rather it was physically, mentally, or emotionally, you're standing next to these men who want to learn and be the best. And so you're already looked at as, you know, they don't even know if you're gonna make it, much less graduate honor grad.
Yeah.
You know? So.
That's what you did, honor
I did.
Grad.
Woo! Oh, yes.
Woo! We got an honor grad.
I actually, out of boot camp, it was 3 months, I was company's highest shooter.
Yeah.
I outshot my company and then went to military police school where I was graduated top of my class, honor grad. And then when I went to corporal's course, I was the honor grad out of corporal's course. Mm-hmm. And so at the end of the day, if I graduate honor grad or not, I know what I'm capable of and I know what type of woman I am.
Mm-hmm.
But it was for the boys because, you know, they have to go in and trust that this woman can do what she needs to do to defend, protect, beside, in front of, and make a decision, a brave decision to stop any given threat at any time.
Yeah.
And so you can't let anybody down, women or men, but with me being the only female on the SWAT team, you know, I had to prove to them, not just to get on the position, but every day prove to them that no matter what the call out was, no matter what the threat was, I was gonna be there by their side, and when we busted the door down, I was gonna make a decision and make sure that I needed to do my part. I needed to hold my weight, and I would take the shot, and I would do what I had to do for my brother to my left and my right. So it was very strenuous, a lot of pressure, you know, but I love pressure, which is why I'm here in WWE. I love challenges.
And I feel like there were probably obviously some men that you came across who didn't want to give you that clout and say like, whatever, she's a woman.
But all the time.
I'm sure that there's a lot of men's minds that you changed. And
yes.
So like, I think, so someone like you who's doing something like that, it's twofold. You're obviously doing it for yourself because you know that you can do that. And there are people who know that you can do that as well.
Right.
But then the people who are against you, but then making them realize that their line of thinking is incorrect.
Yes.
And so you're actually like within the group that you're in, you're helping change perception of things and helping people who come after you.
Yes, and it goes both ways. I mean, I've seen men and women that couldn't hold their weight.
Yeah.
And so it just puts a bad name on women and just people in general. You know, every day, women or men, you have to prove that you have what it takes to be where you are in what position you're in. And I did. I was faced with lots of things. You know, it doesn't help being blonde hair, blue-eyed, you know, oh, look at this, you know, blonde bombshell walking in here. I get it, okay, but just give me a weapon. Give me your weapon and let me show you what I'm capable of, and let's put ourselves in strenuous scenarios where you have to make educated decision, quick decision. You don't have time, and a lot of people can't do that. It's a lot of physical stress, you know, like your body goes through what we call, like in the military police, is like a color code. Like right now we're white, we're relaxed. Mm-hmm. But when it starts going up and like you're faced with a threat or a stressful situation, a lot of people can't make good decisions under those, especially like the last color would be black, mm-hmm. where that if you go black, that's where it's like the fan.
Yeah.
And so we had me and the guys on the team, we have to just prove that any given situation, even the roughest, the hardest, the where your blood feels like it's just leaving your body, you have to make a decision.
Yeah.
Rather, whatever that may be. So yeah, it was difficult, but like I said, I like challenges.
Yeah. So. See, things that I know that I would be terrible at, I can't even make a decision if I'm playing a racing game and there's two roads.
Oh,
I hit the middle. And I'm just playing video games. So
yeah, no.
Well, I can't even imagine. My dad was in the military. He was he was a paratrooper.
And oh,
just,
wow.
Like, he's the man.
Yeah, so, like, it sounds like it. What happened to you?
What happened to me?
We're over here shooting. I mean.
He told me so I was 17, and he said, hey, I want to give you all the information that I can so you can make an educated decision whether you want to go military or whether you want to go right into school or do it after you serve. And the stuff that he told me, I was like, I can't do that. I can't do it. He said he got dropped off like in the desert with a knife and a chicken, had to make his way back to base. And I was like, what? But we lived in Inglewood, California, and like over near like the Bloods and the Crips, like the gangs, right? And so we were living there during the Rodney King riots. And he actually went and like helped, like, I guess like calm the city down.
Really?
When all that stuff was going on. So like just the stuff that he's told me, I was like, you are the man. And there's always this thing of like, a son trying to like test their father, you know, like as they get older. And it's like, I will never do that.
Never.
Ever. But just through all that stuff, I was like, I commend you and everything that you have been through for being a part of the military. So yeah, just hearing all the stories is, I loved him, but he was the man. Let's get one more of these in.
Cool.
Let's see,
I'm
that any better?
Taking my glove off.
Oh my God. Well now, I'm really not gonna, okay.
Fire!
Oh, I think you might have got me.
No, again? What?
It's that trigger finger, honey.
Fine. Whatever.
Whatever.
How much?
I don't know.
What are you shooting at?
There was a bird up there. It was gonna have droppings were gonna hit you.
Freaking terrible. You should come to the range with me. I can help you with this.
I've only been once. Would you like to sit?
Oh, sure.
Okay. Can bring up a chair up here and chat a little bit more. You have a beautiful young daughter.
I do.
And so with the things that you've told me already about being a part of the military, about being a female in WWE, she's around a lot.
Yes.
And how much of not a burden, but how much do you take it upon yourself to make sure that she sees like woman in a strong position so she knows that she can do that?
It's a lot. I mean, it's honestly one of my main motivators to bring her with me on the road and have her travel with me other than wanting to be around my baby, because this job is very It takes a lot of our time, all of our time. Mm-hmm. So, but it is important to me because strong women are what this world needs a lot of the times, because it's, you know, a lot of people in general second guess themselves. And but I, one of my goals is to make sure that my daughter knows what she's capable of, mm-hmm. and as a woman, know what women are capable of in situations, because I, like you said, I did have trouble in the military being a female and in my job. I mean, I even had situations where, you know, I would graduate top of my class on paper, running wise, time wise, physical, educate, like everything. I outdid everybody, right? And you do, you calculate it all up, top of your class, you know, at the time, Sergeant Estrella, and they couldn't accept it. It was, I did favors, you know what I mean, for to get where I am. Yeah. All my awards, it was like, I had a daughter then. Yeah. What, I mean, what, and it just kills me. Yeah. So to have and raise a strong, confident daughter is one of my biggest goals. I even had, we would be on the SWAT team, only female. I would come out of our room, our SWAT, where we sit and plan the attack of the day and this and that, and there'd be a sock hanging on the door. And, you know, and that I don't, you know, I don't know if you know what that means, but like, and so, you know, I would just take it, throw it off, and continue my day, because I know she's going to face a lot as a woman, especially a strong woman. So it's my job to make sure that she is confident in herself in every way, not just I can do what the men can do, blah, blah, blah. But in the kitchen, as a wife, as a mother, it's like there's so much things that women, especially strong ones that are motivated, have to accept and be ready for, because that's just the way the world is. It's intimidating. Strong women can be intimidating to a lot of people.
I think it's like you said, it's very, also very important, because you're not only fighting for your daughter, essentially, you're fighting for so many people's daughters, because a lot of people don't have that opportunity to be, especially in the situation you're in now, to be on television, to be in that limelight where we're on TV every single week for 52 weeks a year. Like, you're an image that people are going to see and uphold, is like, oh, like, I could possibly be that one day.
Right.
Like, she's opening doors for me. She's like you look different. You have a different background than everybody. And that's kind of what I like about, like, WWE as a whole, is that everybody has a different path. So, like, do you find that having the voice that you do now, do you feel like all the things that you've done in your life have kind of culminated into this amazing pie that you could serve up to people, showing them, like, I've done this, and, like, and you can too.
Yeah. That's my goal, that's my hope. When WWE reached out to me, and I, you know, because I didn't watch wrestling growing up, I was completely blindsided, and I had a very rough upbringing. So my final decision, because I never grew up wanting to be famous, I've always wanted to be like a mom and a good wife, and if that's the only thing I ever did, I would have been happy. Because of where I come from and the lifestyle I grew up, a lot of drug addiction, depression, and that's all I knew until I joined the military. When WWE contacted me, and I sat back and thought about it, and how my life could change and the impact that I could make, knowing where I came from, I have to do it.
Yeah.
So it's a lot deeper than just women can wrestle and hard work gets you good places, because there's a lot of people hurting and are going through things that they don't want to talk about, and they just sit there and accept the lifestyle that they feel they're stuck in. And I know what that feels like, and so that's my main goal, is to really impact and motivate people, because I've been there. Yeah. I've been there so many times, and it's the furthest from the truth. That is not the life you have to live.
Yeah.
Just because that's the card you were dealt does not mean that's the deck you have to play with, because life is short and you are capable of anything, and I'm a prime example.
Yeah, I think that a lot of people, I wrestled professionally, started training when I was like 17, and I'm 32 now, and I feel like a lot of people who have been in wrestling a long time, and fans too, sometimes I feel like when people, like, didn't watch wrestling when they were younger, or wrestling wasn't their end all be all throughout their entire life, they kind of have a harder time accepting when people come into the industry, and I assume that you've dealt with some of that. But I think that when people actually get to sit down and hear about the things that you've been through or like why you want to wrestle, why you've taken the opportunity. I think that changes their minds a little bit because I think that a lot of people get, I guess, short-sighted and they say like, oh, well, you don't know the main event of WrestleMania 3 and you don't know this guy or that girl. It's like, oh, well, you shouldn't be here.
Right.
But then I feel like when a lot of people watch this that might think that, they'll say, oh, well, this is why she wrestles.
Right.
And this they'd start to understand things a little bit more. So do you feel like you've been always just been fighting that fight constantly throughout your life, like being told like, oh, you shouldn't be here doing this, and always kind of like trying to set the bar a little bit higher for yourself and others?
For some reason, I just always choose the things that people are just like, what are you doing here?
Yeah.
Well, let me show you what the hell I'm doing here,
yeah.
You know? And that's all that I can say is just, let me show you, because I mean, I'm willing to do whatever it takes to show my worth to get to where I need to get to, because I'm a hard worker.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't back down. So it's like people come, a lot of people, not a lot, but I've seen situations where people come into this business and they didn't watch it growing up, but it's not their thing.
Yeah.
And they, you know, and they leave, this is my thing.
Yeah.
I know what I'm capable of and I enjoy doing this.
Yeah.
The fact that, and that's just a plus for me. That's freaking great, you know?
Yeah.
The fact that I get this platform to help those babies and the young adults that are suffering, people are suffering out there in the world. Like I said, I never thought I'd be famous or be a public figure, but now that I am, damn it, I'm gonna take full advantage of this to help people.
Yeah.
And if it's going in there and performing on Monday Night Raw and coming on here and telling the world, watch freaking WWE because we are the best sports entertainment company in the world, then damn it, I'll say that because we have stories that people need to hear.
Yeah.
And I'm going to take advantage of that no matter what I have to do.
Yeah.
If it's Extreme Rules and going through a table with Becky freaking Lynch sitting on my chest, then damn it, I'll do it. Bring it to me, honey. I've been through a lot worse in my life. I can guarantee you that.
So you've been having a good time.
This is amazing.
Yeah.
I cannot believe I get paid for this.
Yeah.
I was putting myself in deadly situations before I got here and making a hell of a lot less.
Yeah.
And not being able to help the world.
Yeah.
The only people I was helping was the stop and the threat.
Yeah.
And praying I could do so. And I loved it. I really did. I miss it every day.
Yeah.
But now I can, without worrying what's behind me,
mm-hmm.
I can help the world on a bigger platform and people can hopefully hear it and be fixed.
Yeah.
And know that life is not as bad as they feel like it is.
Yeah.
It's not.
Yeah.
You don't have to be famous like me to freaking realize that, because to be honest with you, I sleep in my car on the road loops and I still live in a camper trailer.
Yeah.
That's my life. Don't get it twisted. You see these big hats and these pearls and whatever, and life is great, but I remember where I come from.
Yeah.
I'm a normal human being, and I've been through hell just like the rest of the world out there, just like the babies that are suffering,
mm-hmm.
and if I can make it, so can they.
Yeah. Hell of a message. Hell of a message from Miss Lacey Evans. Limitless
lady.
So on a lighter note, so since you've been able to travel a bunch with WWE, do you have a favorite place that you've been?
Other than Cracker Barrel.
Ooh, I do love Cracker Barrel.
I love it.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Where are you from originally?
I was born in Georgia.
Oh, what?
Yeah.
Whereabouts?
Marietta.
Ma'am.
No way.
Stop it. That's where I grew up.
Are you serious?
Yes.
Yay.
I didn't know that. I went to Sprayberry High School.
Really?
Yes, I'm a Yellow Jacket.
That's...
Yes.
I didn't stay there long because, like I said, my father did construction, so we were back and forth, and between the addiction and everything else, my life was sporadic and crazy, but... and now I live in South Carolina, out by the military base.
Okay.
So on Ladies Island.
Southern lady. Yeah.
Absolutely.
So I was born like near Fort Benning.
Okay.
In Columbus.
Right.
So then we bounced around a little bit. Like I said, Inglewood, then back to Georgia. We lived in Dunwoody. Then we pretty much ended in Marietta. And then I went to college in Greenville, South Carolina, in Furman.
Really? That's where my mom is.
What?
Yeah.
See this? Just bonding. Okay. So you're a fantastic, a Southern belle.
Absolutely.
It's okay. So Cracker Barrel is your spot?
Love it.
Yeah.
And it sucks because I always end up buying stuff that I just need for my house.
And, you're just in the shop.
And I'm like, will this fit in the camper trailer? Yeah. Probably not. Let's maybe I'll buy a pin before I have my eggs. Like, it's terrible. But I love that place.
It's so good. What hurts me is that they're not everywhere.
I know.
Like,
yeah.
When we get like too far out of the South, so like my spot is usually Waffle House.
Really? That's a good one.
There's one like a mile from my house, and I'll walk down there, and they've got like the jukeboxes in there now, and I always play something on the jukebox before I walk in. So there's like a little grand entrance, and I'm like, hey guys, I just need some eggs. But yeah, once we get too far to the South, then all the food's different.
Yep.
I'm like, but I need all day breakfast.
Yeah.
What is going on here?
Yeah, it's my favorite. I always try to Google where it's at, so that way I could get a hotel near there or park my car near there and hang out. But I love Cracker Barrel. But my favorite place I think I've been like state-wise, other than South Carolina, probably Oregon. I think it's beautiful.
Ooh, really?
I don't like the city.
Yeah.
I hate the city. When I was in NXT and I had to live in Orlando, I was miserable.
It's too much going on constantly.
Too many cars and the people move too fast.
Yeah.
And they look miserable. I mean, and I stayed in an apartment for the first, year because for my lease.
Yeah.
And I was miserable there too.
Yeah.
The parking spots were always taken. You can hear everybody. And it was like, so then I just bought a little camper and I parked it at a campsite and just stayed there because I was miserable.
Yeah.
I don't like that life.
Yeah.
Like, geez.
Yeah. It's so when I was down there, it was me, Tyler Breeze and Rick Victor. And well, even before that, I stayed like 30 minutes away from where we trained because I just wanted to be like away from everything. Because like you said, it's in the middle of the city. Everything's just loud. It's crazy. So we had a house that was, again, like 30 minutes from the performance center.
Right.
Because that way we were out on the outskirts.
Yep.
Didn't have to deal with anything. If we went to the store, we didn't have to see everybody.
Yep.
Just like kind of run into Walmart, grab some stuff real quick and go back home. Not that we want to be like asocial and we love people. Yay. People are fantastic. But sometimes.
Yeah.
I totally feel you on that. Just want to chill and relax.
You can't have a bonfire. You can't do s'mores. Like, what kind of life is that?
Yeah.
You can't go fishing.
So you're very outdoorsy.
All the time.
Yeah,
yes, absolutely. I would much rather catch my fish and throw a cast net and catch some shrimp and make dinner than have
really?
To do all the time.
I have never done either of those things.
Are you kidding me?
Never.
This is terrible. It's probably because you spend all your damn time sitting behind a computer screen, honey.
I love it. I get outside enough, so I love rollerblading.
Yeah.
That's my thing, my outside thing, and riding a bike, that works too. But the only time I've ever been fishing is I was a Boy Scout trying to get my like fishing badge.
That's terrible.
And my dad took me to a pond that I found out later he knew there were no fish in. Just so I could get the badge. So I spent like an hour out there. And it was a great time. He's just out there, we're just, doing father-son stuff.
Yeah.
And then we left, and he told him, you put an hour in trying to fish and got the little badge. And then, like, 10 years later, we were telling the story, and he's like, oh, yeah, I knew there were no fish in that pond.
Oh, my God, like, stop.
All right, well,
that is
thanks,
so
Dad.
Funny. Well, you should go fishing with me sometime.
I would love to go fishing with you.
That'd be awesome. And we could
clean
like
it be really bad.
And cook it.
You do the whole deal.
The whole deal. Rather it's shrimp, it doesn't matter. Crab, fish.
What?
Alligator.
So have you ever caught an alligator?
Yeah, absolutely.
What?
Yes, I have.
So my uncle, he used to go fishing a lot, and he'd be on his boat, and he had a very strong rule of like, I only catch
what
to
I
eat.
what I eat. That's exactly what I teach my baby.
Yeah.
We have cows and chickens right now that will be in my refrigerator soon.
Yeah.
But yeah, we raise all of our stuff, and I try to teach her how to, just God forbid something happen.
Yeah.
But so she knows, like she knows the process and the eggs. We go outside and get our eggs and we eat our chickens and the rabbits and everything else. Frog gigging is my favorite thing.
Ma'am?
Frog gigging.
Frog gigging?
Yes.
What is frog gigging?
Well, you go out at night and you catch these bullfrogs and like frog legs. You've had frog legs.
Oh, I have not.
We have to hang out, honey. Like, what are you gonna do when all this system stuff shuts down and you have to go out and get your?
I'm done.
You're not calling me.
I'm done. If we lose technology, we talk about this a lot actually. So like, if the world something happens and all technology is gone, like, we need ways to communicate. I don't know how to make phones. I don't know how to do anything. I don't know how to create any type of technology. I don't know how to fix a car. I don't know how to fix anything mechanical. If your computer goes down, you need some like IT, I got you. But catching fish, no clue. Come Cleaning on. It, cooking it, no clue. Yeah. I'll fight stuff for you.
Yeah.
Like if you need me to fist fight people, I could do that. But if you catch, I'll come and be like on the outskirts to like
Doing
fist
what?
Fight stuff.
Oh, okay. You're gonna protect me.
Yeah. Well, at night when you guys need to sleep, I got you. If you guys can cook me some fish from time to time. So I had no idea you were so what's the word?
Easy with what you say, honey.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm still a classy lady.
Exactly, the classiest lady. Who can also constantly get the job done in whatever situation she's placed into.
Bake a pie there just as good as I could fire a weapon. I like to cook.
What's your favorite meal to cook?
What my husband likes. Chicken fried steak.
Ooh, okay.
Baked macaroni and cheese, mashed potatoes, and green beans.
Ooh,
that's
okay.
Like his, that's homemade his gravy on top.
Yeah, he's had a rough day, that's his go-to.
But we're trying to eat better, but whenever I feel like whipping it up, you know, that's one of my, other than that, the fish, shrimp from the water and baked chicken I try to eat more of.
Yeah.
Watch my figure, but.
Well, you're killing it.
Thank you.
This has been great. I love this episode. I've learned so much. All right. Well, hey, Limitless Lady, thank you for being on. I appreciate you spending
thank
the time
with
us.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for beating me in quick draw.
Yeah.
Sure. Look, you know what? Can we get one more round in before
Absolutely.
You go?
If you feel like losing one more time.
I feel like losing one more time. I'm going to take the things I've learned about you. I'm going to use them.
Just give it up if that's the case. Oh, look you in the eye.
Ready. Steady. Fire!
Oh!
Again! Again!
And that's how it's done, honey.
Fine. Give a round of applause, everybody.
This is fun.
Thank you for being on. Appreciate you.
Thank you for having me.
Where can they find you on socials?
At Lacey Evans, WWE.
Perfect. Links in the description below. Follow her because she's got a fantastic journey so far and a fantastic journey ahead of her. Limitless Lady, ladies and gentlemen, until next time. Always and forever, keep it tight.